Robin's an Emeritus Professor from the Open University and also Gresham College. And his research interests are in graph theory, in particular the four-colour map theorem, I told from Wikipedia. So that's the minimum number of colours that are needed to colour a map so that every county is in a different colour, neighbouring county is in a different colour. And it took 100 years to find the solution to it. So one fascinating thing about Robin is that he has an Erdos number of 1. Now, not being a mathematician, I didn't realise what that meant until this afternoon. So Paul Erdos was a highly prolific mathematician in the 20th century, and he wrote 1,500 journal papers. And as a tribute to him when he passed away, his friends developed this thing called the Erdos number, which is a bit like the Bacon number, but for mathematicians, so it's a degree of separation thing. So if you have an Erdos number of 1, that means you collaborated directly with Paul Erdos himself. And there are only about 500 people in the world who have that to their name. So one very useful thing about Robin, I suppose, is that he's written very many books on the history of mathematics, and he is passionate about getting out there and telling the story of maths. And so this evening he's going to talk to us about the story of pi. But to help him plug a new book, which is coming out next week, he's got a book called The Turing Guide coming out next week. And there's some information about that on the posters on the door. I'm sure he'd be grateful if you buy a copy. And now I'll hand over to him. Thank you very much, Robin.
Thank you very much. So thank you to the organisers for organising this meeting, and thank you for all coming. It's wonderful to see so many people here coming for an hour of mathematics on a cold evening. Just a favourite project of mine, a new value of pi to assign. I would fix it at 3, for it's simple, you see, than 3.14159. Well, 3.14159 is the number pi that we're talking about today. It goes on longer than that. There's a lot more digits there. And more digits there. Actually, I have a friend that memorized all of these. But not these. It's what we call an irrational number. It goes on and on forever. And so pi never stops. How many digits do we know to pi? Well, you'll hear about that at the end of the talk. So let's remind ourselves what pi is. But first of all, just to say that pi appears everywhere. If you go to the Vienna metro, go to one of the stops, you'll see all the a lot of the digits of pi are all the way around the station. So what is pi? Pi, as you will know, is the ratio of the circumference of the circle to its diameter. The circumference is pi times d, or 2 pi r, where r is the radius. But it's also the area of a circle of radius 1. The area is pi r squared, if r is the radius. So the radius is 1, it's just equal to pi. I don't know if you've ever wondered why the same number pi occurs in these two completely different formulae. One formula is about the circumference, another is the area. Why should the same number occur? And as the ratio of the circumference to a circle to its diameter, it's for a tiny circle, it's for a large circle. Any circle in the world, you still get the same number pi arising. So what's the connection between these two problems? Well, here's one way of thinking about it. On the top left, you can see a circle, or a disk, if you like, circumference 2 pi r. And supposing you take two of these, a shaded one and a white one, then you can rearrange them as shown in the second picture. And so we've got the area of this. We don't know the area yet, but it's certainly twice the area of the circle. And you get that funny shape there. But instead of taking four sectors, supposing you take 8, then you get a picture like the one below. And again, the area is twice the area of the circle. Now, supposing instead of taking 8, you take more and more and more. The more you take, then the more that shape is going to look like that rectangle at the bottom. And the height of the rectangle is r. The length is 2 pi r. So the area is 2 pi r squared. And remember, that's twice the area we're looking for, so the area is pi r squared. So if we know the 2 pi r in the first picture, we can deduce the area is pi r squared, and you can reverse the whole argument to show it the other way around. And this is quite an old proof. You can actually see on the right a 17th century Japanese manuscript which has the same proof on it. First of all, how do you remember pi? As I said, I had this friend that knows 500 digits. Certainly you can remember some. How I wish I could calculate pi. If you count the number of letters in each word, you get 3141592. Okay? May I have a large container of coffee? That gives you an extra digit. How I need a drink, alcoholic of course, after all these lectures informing history audiences or quantum mechanics or whatever, involving quantum mechanics. You can think of your own thing, but again, you get several digits there. And pi, of course, is a Greek word. It's actually the first letter of periphery, and that's how it came in. The use of pi to denote this constant, you think would go back to the Greeks, but in fact it was 1706 when a Welshman called William Jones was writing a book, and I've actually found the reference recently, and you can actually see the very first appearance of pi, and he used it, as I say, as short for periphery, the first letter of the Greek word for periphery. Anyway, here's a Greek sentence. And if you, it basically says, great God ever geometrizes to define the circle length by its diameter, dot, dot, dot. If you count the number of letters in each of these Greek words, again, you get quite a few of the digits of pi there. If that's not enough, here's a whole story. For a time, I stood pondering on circle sizes. The large computer mainframe quietly processed all of its assembly code. Inside, my entire hope lay for figuring out an elusive expansion, value of pi. It's pretty awful stuff. I'm not going to read it all, but anyway, this gives you the first 300 digits of pi, as long as you have a mechanism for dealing with zero. And I think the zero was mainly some form of hyphen or dash or bit of punctuation. But anyway, that gives you the first 300 digits of pi, apparently. Here's a little puzzle. Some letters of the alphabet have vertical symmetry. If you take A and flip it, you've still got A. If you have B and you flip it, you don't get B. So C doesn't work, D doesn't work, E works. Let's look at which ones work. I've actually crossed out all the ones approximately, which have got vertical symmetry. So A goes, B, C, and D, E, F, and G don't. H has vertical symmetry, so does I. J, K, L, M does, N doesn't, O does, and so on. So I've crossed out the ones that have vertical symmetry. And we can now, starting from J, let's count the number of letters. 3, J, K, L, 3, 1, 4, 1, 6. And so you can get the first digits of pi. There's nothing too mathematical in that. And I couldn't go any further. But I thought you might like to see that, because it's silly. So let's now look about where pi first arose. What are the historical origins of pi? And to do this, we go back to the earliest times of the history of mathematics. Well, certainly some of the earliest bits of mathematics we know about are Egyptian and Mesopotamian, sometimes called Babylonian mathematics. So for the Mesopotamians, around 1800 BC, they actually found, presumably by experimentation, something about the ratio of the perimeter of a hexagon to the circumference of the circle. Now, if you put a hexagon inside a circle, if the circle is radius r, then the side of the hexagon will be r as well. It's made of 6 equilateral triangles, and they actually managed to find that the ratio of the perimeter of the hexagon to the circumference of the circle was, in their notation, 0.5736. We use a decimal place value system. where we have sort of units and tens and hundreds and so on. And so did the Mesopotamians. They had a place value system, but it was based on 60. We still use that 60, incidentally, for 60 seconds in a minute and 60 minutes in an hour. And we still use it for angles. But anyway, they somehow came up with this answer. So let's actually see what this means. Ratio of the perimeter of the hexagon, that's 6r, six lots of r, over 2 pi r, which of course is 3 over pi. And this means 57 60ths and 36 hundredths. Well, I don't know how they found this, but this certainly appears on one of the clay tablets that they produced. And if you actually work out what it all means, you find that pi is 3 and an eighth, which is about 3.125. 3.125 is a pretty good approximation for that time. It's a slightly lower estimate, but it's very, very accurate. Here's another one. This is an upper estimate. And this is the Egyptians. Now, we don't know so much about Egyptian mathematics because they wrote on papyrus, which is a sort of reed, and those don't survive the centuries very well. But there are two main papyruses, one in the British Museum and the other in Moscow. And the British Museum one is called the Rhind Papyrus after the Victorian explorer who bought it. And it has about 80 problems on it. And problem number 50 says, example of a round field of diameter 9 ket, that's some sort of unit, what is its area? And the papyrus, you can see it here, you may not be able to read hieratic script, but just in case you can't, what it says is you take away a ninth of the diameter, which is 1 here, the remainder is 8. Multiply 8 by 8, it makes 64, therefore it contains 64 sitat of land. In other words, their method, which again, presumably they found by experience, is if you have a certain diameter, you take away a ninth of it and then square the result. So the diameter is d, you subtract a ninth d, which gives you 8 ninths d, and then that's 64 over 81 d squared. But d, the diameter, is twice the radius, so it's 256 over 81 r squared, and 256 over 81 is about 3.16. So they had, again, a very, very good approximation, within 1%, but unlike the Mesopotamians, it's an overestimate. What was this papyrus used for? Quite possibly for teaching, because otherwise, why would you have chosen the diameter to be 9? They were teaching their scribes, and they chose the diameter 9 so that you can actually take away the ninth of diameter very easily. And there are two or three problems on the papyrus, this papyrus, which has problems to do with measuring areas of circles, and they all involve a diameter of 9 so that they can carry out this rule. 1,000 years later, there's a biblical value which is not nearly as accurate as either. If you look in 1 Kings 7:23 or 2 Chronicles 4:2, also he made a molten sea of 10 cubits from brim to brim round in compass and 5 cubits the height thereof. That's irrelevant. And a line of 30 cubits did compass it round about. So you've got 10 cubits from brim to brim, that's the diameter, and 30 cubits compass it round about, so pi is 30 over 10, which is 3. 3 is much more convenient, as you saw in that limerick at the beginning. And, for many purposes, it's good enough for what you need. But it certainly isn't nearly as accurate as either of the values we saw earlier on. In India, meanwhile, they were discovering various values around AD 380. Someone came up with 3 and 177 over 1250. That's a pretty good approximation. That's 3.1416, which is essentially 4 decimal places. But one of the first really important Indian mathematicians, Aryabhatta, he's so famous that, in fact, when the Indians decided to send up a satellite into space, they called it Aryabhatta. And what did Aryabhatta do? He worked on various problems, including pi. He was also the first one to sum to give formally for summing an arithmetic progression, if for those that know what that means. Anyway, how do you find pi? Again, how we got this, heaven knows. Add 4 to 100, multiply by 8, and add 62,000, as you would. The result is approximately the circumference of a circle with diameter 20,000. So he wrote this down, all in words. but if you actually work out what it means, it's 62,832 over 20,000. Again, 3.1416, a very accurate approximation for the time. There were various other people around the place. Brahmagupta was the second really important Indian mathematician. He was the one who first gave the rules for calculating with zero. Zero had just come in India around the time, and he sort of explained how to calculate it with it, how to add zeros and subtract things from zeros and multiply and so on. Now, his approximation to pi was the square root of 10, 3.162. It's not right, but it's a pretty good approximation, and it was widely used in many countries at the time. You'll see another one in just a moment. But before you do, let's now turn to Greece, because one of the really important cultures in the history of mathematics is the Greek culture. It's where the idea of proof came along. When we do mathematics now, pure mathematics in particular, you start off with some axioms, some definitions and axioms, and you prove some simple results. And then on the basis of this, you prove some more complicated ones using logical deduction. You build a whole hierarchy of results with everything depending on what came below. And one of the most famous books in the whole of mathematics, if not the most famous book in the whole of mathematics, was Euclid's Elements, which for many years was regarded as the model of how to use deductive reasoning in geometry and arithmetic. Anyway, around the same time as Euclid, around 250 BC, was Archimedes, and he decided to find pi by approximating it by polygons, like hexagons. He wasn't the first to do this. There are a couple of others, a chap called Antiphon that came before who tried to do it, but Archimedes is the most well-known one. And he said, well, supposing you want to find the circumference of a circle, it's certainly greater than the perimeter of the hexagon that's inside. And it's less than the perimeter of a hexagon drawn outside. If you look at the smaller pictures, you'll see a circle with a hexagon inside and outside. And if you look at the perimeters and compare it to the circumference, you find that the upper and lower bounds for when you've got six, it says it's more than 3 and it's less than 3.464. True, not very good. So what Archimedes then did is, and you indicate this, he halved each of these arcs and drew an extra couple of lines in. So instead of having a six-sided polygon, you've got a 12-sided one, a dodecagon. And there, here you can see a dodecagon inside a circle and outside. And there he found, by comparing the perimeters, that the inside one was 3.105, the outside one was 3.215. Good. Better, but not good enough. So Archimedes then went to 24, 3.133 and 3.160, and 48 and 96. He went as far as that. He didn't draw these things, of course, but he did the calculations. And he found in the end that pi lies between, it's just a little bit less than 3 and a 7, that's 22 over 7. Pi is not equal to 22 over 7, it's a little bit less, but it's a little bit more than 3 and 10 over 71. So it lies between 3 and 10 over 71 and 3 and 10 over 70. Or in terms of decimals, which of course they didn't have, it's 3.14084 or 3.14286. So in other words, it gives you pi to what we now call two decimal places. Okay, as I said, they didn't have decimals then, but those are that shows the degree of accuracy. Well, using that idea, you can push the number up further. So far, we've got up to 96 sides. And you can look at either perimeters or areas. Antiphon looked at areas, and various other people looked at areas. Others looked at perimeters. So you can double it to 192, 384, 768. Let's carry on. And the Chinese did this. Before I mention what they did, let's just mention Zhang Heng. Anyone heard of Zhang Heng? Yes? What did he invent? Do you know? Yeah, but in particular, he also invented the seismograph for measuring earthquakes. And he was about AD 100, and he actually gave the approximation, the square root of 10. And I apologize if I pronounce them incorrectly. But then along came Louis Hui. He was actually writing, there's a famous Chinese book called The Nine Chapters of the Mathematical Art, which was from, we don't know exactly when, but probably about 200 BC. And he was doing a new edition of this. It had all sorts of things about calculating square roots, and it had methods of solving simultaneous equations. In fact, those of you who have heard of Gaussian elimination for solving systems of simultaneous equations, Gauss's method is exactly the same as was given in this book of in China in 200 BC. Gauss was about 2,000 years too late. But the method is exactly the same. Anyway, Li Hui, here's a dodecagon, but he then started doubling the number of sides, and he went as far, basically, as 3,072 sides. And he got formulas that he used, or methods that he used. Each time he doubled, he could write the new perimeter and the new area in terms of the old ones. And from these, he got more better and better approximations. He got 3.14159. Even better was Zhu Zhongji and his son around the year AD 500. And they doubled several times more, three times more, is it, to give 24,576 sides. And they did the calculations, and they got this value here, which is correct to 6 decimal places. Quite remarkable. In fact, for those that collect stamps, I collect mathematical stamps. I have about 1,500 of them. And I actually have a stamp showing Zhu Zhongji with the value of pi just below it. And so if you're on the way to the Chinese post office, you can learn some geometry at the same time. But he and his son also found the approximation given here. As I say, we're all familiar with 22 over 7 as an approximation for pi. An even better one is 355 over 113, which, as I'm sure you've all calculated immediately in your head, gives you pi to 6 decimal places. And this particular approximation wasn't rediscovered in Europe for another 1,000 years. Quite remarkable. It's one of many occasions where the Chinese got there way before anyone in the West. Anyway, this idea of using polygons was really quite a useful way of finding approximations to pi, and it was used by several people in Europe and nearby. I mean, Fibonacci, some of you will have known about the Fibonacci sequence. He wrote a famous book called Liber Abaci, the Book of Calculation, in 1202, which was partly designed to introduce the Hindu-Arabic numerals that we use today, the decimal place value system that we use today. And it had lots of problems in it. Some of you will know about the problem of the rabbits, which leads to the Fibonacci sequence. If you don't, go away and read about it, but I won't spend time on it today. But he actually looked at, as Archimedes did, at polygons with 96 sides, and was more careful about it, and got essentially 3.141818. Al-Kashi, meanwhile, in Samarkand, he was head of the observatory in Samarkand, he managed to find it to 14 decimal places. And then along came the Dutch, two gentlemen here from the 16th century, and the first one found that pi was a little bit less than, using polygons with 10 to the ninth sides, again, doing the calculation, 10 to the ninth side, found pi is a little bit less than 377 over 120 and a little bit more than 333 over 106. And they said, therefore, to give a good approximation, let's average the tops and average the bottoms. And he got, by complete coincidence, 355 over 113. Which was the value known in China 1,000 years earlier. But again, that's just luck that the numbers happen to work out that way. Then there's Adrian van Roman, who looked at polygons with 2 to the 30 sides and found 15 decimal places. In France, Francois Viette, whom we'll meet again in a few minutes' time, used polygons with 393,000 sides, got just 9 decimal places. And then a remarkable guy called Ludolf van Keulen from 1615, well, he got 2 values, and eventually he looked at 60 times 2 to the 29 sides, which is several billion, I think it's 4 billion billion sides, and he found 35 decimal places. He spent 20 years doing this, and he was so proud of his results, he said that when he died, he wanted it to be put on his tombstone. Here's a picture of him, which I discovered in Ireland, in Dublin, just a few months back. So here's a picture of van Keulen, and underneath you can see his upper and lower estimates to pi to 20 decimal places in that circle there. Here is his value, and as I say, he was the one who had it on his tombstone. Later that disappeared. I think they've put a new tombstone there which has the numbers on it, so you can go and see it if you want to. So that's the end of one of our stories. One of our stories is using polygons with increasing numbers of sides to approximate from above and below values of pi. But how about exact values? Well, there are 2 really important ones around the year 1600. And one was the French one by Viette, and another one was an English one by John Wallace. And Viette came out with this exact formula. 2 over pi is equal to root 2 over 2 times root of 2 plus root 2 over 2 times root of 2 plus root 2 plus root 2 over 2 times. And you can go on and writing as many terms as you like and calculating these things. I mean, you can see this expressed in various different ways. There are different ways of writing it out. It actually doesn't converge very fast to pi, but it was the first exact formula for pi. And then along came Wallace, and I'll show you how he got it in just a minute. Then Wallace said pi over 2 is 2 times 2 times 4 times 4 times 6 times 6 times, and on the bottom 1 times 3 times 3 times 5. So it's basically 2 over 1 times 2 over 3 times 4 over 3 times 4 over 5 times 6 over 5 times 6 over 7, and you can go on as far as you like, and stop, and then that'll give you an approximation. Again, it doesn't converge very fast, but let me actually show you how they got these. So here's Viette's method, and if you don't understand this, don't worry, wake up in a minute or two, and we'll carry on with the story. So what he's doing, he's looking at the area inside an n-sided polygon of radius r. So let's look at AN. So you've got the blue triangle, and AB is the side of an n-sided polygon, okay? And so the total area is n times the area of OAB, and those of you who know this formula will know that the area of OAB is a half r squared sine of the angle between them. So you've got a triangle, the area is one side times another side times the sine of the angle between, all divided by 2. So it's a half r squared sine 2 theta. If you now add the point C, so you're doubling the number of sides, then you've got 2n, we're looking at OAC now, 2n times a half r squared sine, it's only 1 theta this time. So an over a2n is cos theta. And now you go on further, you can find a4n, a8n, and so on. Well, an over a4n is an over 2n times a2n over a4n, the a2n's cancel, so that's cos theta times cos theta over 2. And each time you multiply by cos theta divided by another power of 2. So if you carry on k times, you're going to get cos theta over 2 times cos theta over 4 times, and so on. Now, if k gets larger and larger and larger, then the area of the polygon will get closer and closer and closer to the area inside the circle, which is pi r squared. And so that gives you a result for pi r squared. That gives you an in terms of all these causes times pi r squared. And to get Viet's result, we take a particular case. We take n equals 4, so theta is 45 degrees. We know what cos 45 degrees is. It's 1 over root 2. And, a over 4 is 2 r squared, and so on. So taking the first one just gives you the root 2 over 2. And then each of these extra cosines corresponds to the extra terms with all the extra root 2s. So each of those, so what you've got is that 2 over pi is cos 45 degrees times cos 22 and a half degrees times cos 11 and a quarter and so on. And so that's the exact result. Now, John Wallis's formula, this actually isn't quite what he did, but one way you can get this is you can try and find the area under, we want to find the area of a circle. So one way of doing it is to find out the area of a quarter circle and multiply by 4. And what you can do that, if you know calculus, is you can actually, so here's a quarter circle, and instead of taking the quarter circle, you put a whole lot of rectangles in them, and you work out the areas of the rectangles and add them all up and wave your hands and say abracadabra, and what you get at the end, well, pi over 4 is that integral for those who know about calculus, and you can approximate that in this way, and that eventually leads to this formula. This is a first year undergraduate type material. I won't go into it today, but I'm just showing you the sort of thing that was going on around that time, the mid-17th century. Now, here's something you may or may not have come across, continued fractions. Continued fractions are things like this expression here. They're called continued fractions because they're fractions and they go on forever. Well, they could be finite, but these ones go on forever. Now, Brouncker, who was the first president of the Royal Society, he came up with this one. He said 4 over pi is, well, you can just look at the first number, that's 1. Well, that doesn't give you a very good approximation. That gives you pi equals 4. So let's now move a little to the right and say it's 1 plus 1 squared over 2. That's 1.5, okay? And then you can go further. You can go 1 plus 1 over 2 plus 9 over 2. Well, 2 plus 9 over 2 is, heaven knows what, 6.5. Turn it upside down, 2 over 13, and you get 15 over 13. And then take one stage further, you get 105 over 76, and so on. And so you get better and better approximation. And you can see the pattern, can't you? On the bottom, you've got 1, 2, and 1, and then a whole lot of 2s. And on top, you've got 1 squared, 3 squared, 5 squared, 7 squared, 9 squared. A really beautiful formula. If you look on the right, there's nothing to do with pi there. You've got the 1s and the 2s, and then you've got the squares of the odd numbers. And yet, if you scrunch them all together in this sort of way, you get a number involving pi. Amazing. And in fact, as I say, you can go as far as you like and get better and better approximations. So those red numbers are all approximations to 4 over pi, and you can work out what pi is. And even it doesn't converge particularly fast. A better one is by a chap called Lambert, who is Swiss. Very strange chap. When he spoke to you, he always looked at you sideways. You see, you're over there and I'm talking to you. But quite an eccentric guy, but very, very brilliant. And he came up with this one. Again, here the pattern isn't obvious. You've got ones on the top, and you've got 3, 7, 15, 1, 2, 9, 2. It's not clear what the pattern is at all. But he came up with this. And in fact, if you then work out the bits as you take more and more of the fraction, you get 3, 22 over 7, we know that, 3 over 106, 355 over 113, we know that, and so on. So this picks up a lot of the values that we've come across in the past. And there are several different continued fraction approximations to pi. It's time for a new story. Okay, so we've had, first of all, the approximation by polygons, and then we have the exact formulae that we've just seen. One of the most successful ways, though, was using the arctan function. I don't know whether these days you talk about arctan or tan to the minus 1, but basically if you have a triangle here, you can see that the tangent tan theta is A over B. And so we actually say that theta is tan to the minus 1, A over B, or some people say arctan, A over B. So for example, you know that tan of pi over 4, which is tan, this is using radian measures. Basically, the idea is that radian measures concerns if you've got an arc of a circle, it's basically a measure. If you've got a whole circle, 2 pi is corresponds to 360 degrees, pi corresponds to 180, and 1 radian is about 57 degrees. And so pi by 4 will be 45 degrees. Tan of 45 degrees is 1. So tan to the minus 1 of 1 is pi by 4. We use radian measures because it makes the formulae so much nicer. It's also a number rather than having to talk about degrees or any other sort of unit. Tan of pi by 6, that's tan of 30 degrees, is 1 over root 3. So tan to the minus 1 of 1 over root 3 is pi by 6. And you can combine these. I won't go into the details, but this picture here, you can actually see the angle near the bottom is 10 to the minus 1 of a half, because you've got 1 down the side and 2 along the bottom, so that's 10 to the minus 1 of a half, and the one above it you can actually show without too much difficulty, it's 10 to the minus 1 of a third, and if you add those two together, you're going to get 45 degrees. So 10 to the minus 1 of a half plus 10 to the minus 1 of a third equals pi by 4. Don't worry if you don't understand the details, just come along with the general flow, okay? And in general, there is a formula which enables you to add two 10 to the minus 1s together, okay? Well, don't worry too much about the details, but the point is that 10 to the minus 1 you can actually write out in terms of what we call a power series. It's like a polynomial with x's and x squares and x cubes and so on, but it goes on forever. And it was proved by Leibniz and various other people at the time, although in fact this particular, the 10 to the minus 1 x, you can approximate it by x or by x minus x cubed over 3 plus x to the fifth over 5 minus x to the seventh over 7 plus and so on, and that k means meant to be three dots. I don't know why it's come out as a K, but here we are. So if you put x equals 1, you get pi by 4 is 1 minus a third plus a fifth minus the seventh plus. Again, that's dot, dot, dot. That is one of the most amazing results in mathematics. You should be excited by that. You're taking the fractions, 1, a third, a fifth, a seventh, and so on, and adding and subtracting them. There's no reason on earth, seemingly, why that's anything to do with the circle measurement. And yet, if you do that forever, a very simple, easy to describe series, do it forever, you get pi by 4. And this is a result of Leibniz and Gregory, but it was also known several centuries earlier in India. Madhavar is one of these people that discovered this. Those of you who saw Marcus de Sautoy's programs on the story of maths, which were on television a few years ago. And if you haven't, you should. They're all on YouTube, 4 documentaries of 1 hour, and you'll actually see, I think it's in the second one, yes, it's in the second one, you see some shooting in India, some shots shown in the jungle, and there's an animation which shows pi over 4 equal to this formula here. So that's a wonderful result. It's so simple. And yet, in some ways, it's magic. But it's not much use for calculating pi. If you take 300 terms, that's only going to give you 2 decimal places. If you take 10,000 terms, it'll only give you about 5, I think. So it's not practically very good. But we can use properties of arctan, of 10 to the minus 1, to get better approximations. Because we know that pi over 4 is 10 to the minus 1 of a half plus 10 to the minus 1 of a third. So putting in a half into our formula at the top, we get that bracket there. As I say, each k means dot, 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 means carries on forever. So you get a half minus an eighth over 3 plus a 32nd over 5 and so on. Now those fractions, get much smaller, much more quickly than the third, a fifth, and a seventh. And then from the third, you've got 1/3 cubed, 1/3 to the 5th. With all those powers of 3 on the bottom, again, that converges very, very fast, well, certainly much faster than the original one, and you can calculate pi to a good degree of approximation more easily. But you can do better still. Here are some better series. And the most famous one, I think, is due to John Machin of 1706. 1706, I remind you, was the year in which William Jones first came up with a symbol for pi. It didn't really catch on until Leonard Euler, for me, one of the greatest mathematicians of all time, my favorite mathematician, he used it extensively, and that helped get it established. Euler introduced various other things like I for the square root of minus 1, E for the exponential number, sigma for summations, and so on. But anyway, this is resulted due to Machin, who was a mathematics teacher in London. And the advantage of this one is it's 4 times 10 to the minus 1 of a fifth minus 10 to the minus 1 of 139. I won't go into how you get that. You get it by applying that formula I showed you earlier about 10 to the minus 1 x plus 10 to the minus y. Do it several times, you end up with this formula. But what's nice about it is that, first of all, it gives you 1 over 5 minus 1 over 5 cubed over 3 plus 1 over 5 to the fifth over 5 minus dot, dot, dot. And those are easy to calculate. Well, first of all, it converges quite quickly because of the fives, the powers of 5 in the bottom. But also, they're easy to calculate because 5 is a nice, easy number to calculate with. Okay? And so he was able to find 100 decimal places. I didn't mention the second term. It's the same with 1 over 239. Of course, all the 239s in the denominators, again, those terms get very small very quickly. And so you get a very good approximation. And that was used for a couple of centuries, well, certainly a century and a half, to give more and more values for pi. Euler, whom I mentioned a few minutes ago, came up with the second one. Again, you've got a fifths, and then the 1 over 70 and 1 over 99, those are large enough that the convergence is very, very quick, and Euler found 200 places. And then some called Loney, whom I can't remember who he was, but anyway, he had another one, and he had 528 places. And then Gauss, who's one of the most famous mathematicians of all time, from the beginning of the 19th century, he had another formula, and I can't remember how many places he got, but he certainly made some good results from there. So the new values for pi we got, well, Machin got 100 places, Delany, Vega, various people like that, 140 places, Richter, 500, Shanks got 707 places, but got a lot of them wrong. And then once the computers came in, Ferguson got 808. A couple of things to say here. Vega, who was Slovenian, and the Slovenians were very proud of it. Vega was also one of the inventors of logarithms. Logarithms were first published by John Napier in 1614, a Scotsman, but also slightly earlier by a chap called Jost Bjørgi, but who didn't publish them until after Napier had. So he was involved with the story of logarithms, but Vega came up with 140 places. And then the story was that a Dutchman, I think, was visiting Oxford, and he found a more accurate value in a book in the Bodleian Library. And he reported on this, that he had seen a value of pi to, well, there's 154 places, in fact, of which 152 were correct. And he reported on this in his writings. He used to write a diary. And this was, if you look at all the books on the history of pi, you'll see it reference that. But no one knew exactly what that source was, because the Bodleian Library's got huge numbers of books and everything. Well, I was in Slovenia about 3 years ago, and someone asked me, because they wanted to know who it was, because of course they were great supporters of Vega. And so I said, well, I actually know someone who does a lot of research on this sort of thing in the Bodleian Library. So I gave him the task saying, can you find in the Bodleian Library this reference by this baron who visited in the late 1700s? And he did. And he found it. And it was actually, and we don't know who had written it. It's a big book of 500 pages of handwriting. And somewhere in lots and lots of calculations, and he'd used the 10 to the minus 1 series. And he'd managed to find pi to 154 places, and we found out where it is. As I say, we don't know who did it, but again, that was the best value for a century until these other ones came. Now, Shanks came up with 707 places, again using Machin's formula, and the Palais de la Découverte in Paris thought this was wonderful. And if you go there, you can go in their pi room, and you can see all these values. But unfortunately, it was discovered later on that, in fact, only the first 527 are correct. And they'd already done the building by then. So you've got a lot of these incorrect values of pi if you go into this room. But it's all quite fun. OK, well, the rest of the talk is going to be in the last 10, 15 minutes at most. I'm just going to talk about odd results which relate to pi. Some of them you will understand, some of you won't. Some of them you'll find interesting, some of them you'll think are silly, but anyway. So here's one way of finding pi. You throw needles. I did this once, actually. We had for A-level physics, we had to do various experiments, of course. But the physics master was away one day, and he gave us access to the physics lab, said, use any equipment you like, which is a pretty dangerous thing to say. Well, I didn't want to do any of this physics stuff. So I decided to do Buffon's needle experiment by throwing 100 matches. And so the idea is that you throw matches onto here, onto a grid of lines, and see how many matches cross the line. So, you are. This is clever. So, suppose you can throw 10, okay? Now, you can do a simple calculation in trigonometry to show that if L is the length of the needle and A is the distance between the lines, then the probability of crossing a line turns out to be 2 over pi times L over A. Why is pi coming in here? Well, that's understandable. It's trigonometry, so that's okay. Now, here you've got 5 over 10 crossing the line. And so this actually, if you work it through, gives you pi is about 3.2. I got 3.21. In fact, you can get the more you throw, then the more accurate it's going to be. So here's a practical way of finding pi, but it won't give you a huge amount of accuracy. Actually, there was a guy in the 19th century who did actually get 6 decimal places by having particular lines and throwing matches so many times. But it was pure luck, because if just one of them had landed differently, he'd have only got 2 decimal places. So it was. Here's another bizarre result. This is the great Gauss, Carl Friedrich Gauss. And supposing you draw a circle and you look at all the points here. All the points here are ones with coordinates which are whole numbers. Now, supposing you let Rn be the number of ways of writing n as a sum of 2 squares. And I'll show you how to count them. There are 8 ways of writing 5 as a sum of 2 squares. It's 2 squared plus 1 squared. Or it's 1 squared plus 2 squared, which you regard as different. Or it's minus 2 squares plus 1 squared. Or it's minus 1 squared, minus 2 squared. And so there are 8 ways of doing it, okay? 7, you can't do at all. 250, you can do 16 times. 251, you can't do at all. So it's a very up and down type formula, isn't it? Up and down type result. So it's very erratic. So instead, we look at the averages, and we've got this k again. So it's r1 plus r2 plus dot, dot, dot plus rn over n. So you average the first n. And that average, as n gets larger and larger, tends to pi. Again, amazing. Why on earth does pi come in there? So it's a very weird number, this pi. I'm going to get more theoretical for about 2 or 3 minutes. I mentioned that pi is irrational. It's not a fraction. You can't write it as one whole number over another. I mean, it's pretty obvious if you look at it, it's irrational, but how do you prove it? And it was our friend Lambert again, the one who had the continued fraction. And he proved that if x is a rational number, that's a fraction, other than zero, then its tangent must be irrational. Okay? So turning that around, if tan x is rational, then x must be irrational or zero. But we know that tan of pi by 4, that's 45 degrees, is 1, which is rational. So pi by 4 is irrational. It can't be written as a fraction, and therefore pi can't be written as a fraction either. So by this result that he proved, you have a very simple proof that pi cannot be written as a fraction. But you can go further. Just hold on to your seats for a bit. It won't take long. So we talk about the irrational numbers we can split further. We talk about that some of them are algebraic and some of them are not algebraic. And the not algebraic ones we call transcendental because they transcend the algebra, as Euler put it. So the square root of 2, the cube root of 7 and root 2 plus root 3, they're algebraic numbers because you can write them as roots of equations with whole number coefficients. So root 2, that's a solution of x squared minus 2 is 0, or if you like, x squared equals 2. And that's an equation where all the coefficients are whole numbers. It's just 1 and 2. Cube root of 7, that's x cubed minus 7 is 0, or x cubed equals 7. Root 2 plus root 3, I'll leave that as an exercise to show that that satisfies x to the 4th minus 10x squared plus 1. Again, all whole numbers, 1 minus 10, 1. And so they're all algebraic. Numbers that are not algebraic, in other words, where you can't write them as a root of such an equation, are transcendental. And two really rather difficult problems were solved in the late 19th century. The French mathematician Emeritus showed that E is transcendental, and Lindemann, a German, proved that pi is transcendental. Incidentally, for those that know about these things, that actually settled once and for all the ancient Greek question of whether you can square the circle. If you've got a circle, can you find a square whose area is the same as the given circle? When I say find, I mean can you construct it with straight edge and compasses is the rule of the game. And for 2,000 years, it wasn't known whether you could do that or not, and you can't because pi is not algebraic. And basically, just very quickly, Lindemann proved this result that if you have a whole lot of distinct algebraic numbers, and they can be real or imaginary, and similarly a whole lot of other numbers, not necessarily distinct, not all zero, then you've got that result must be not zero. But there's a famous result called e to the pi I plus 1 equals 0, one of the most wonderful results in mathematics. And you even find it on a tie. And next week I'm handing in a book about this result with different chapters for each of the five constants, 1, 0, pi, e, and I, which hopefully will come out later this year. Perfect Christmas present for you. Actually, I wrote another mathematics book on the four-colour problem, which you mentioned earlier on, and it came out just before Christmas. I gave it to all my friends for Christmas. It solved my Christmas present problems for that year. The result was I lost all my friends, so it solved my Christmas present my Christmas present problems for the following year as well. Anyway, this famous result, which again is just one of the most amazing in mathematics, because it involves the five most important constants in mathematics. You've got e, the exponential number, pi, which you know about, I is the square root of minus 1, which doesn't even exist, add 1, you get 0. Anyway, you can read all about it in due course. But anyway, that using that formula, that shows you that pi I is not algebraic, and therefore pi is transcendental. Okay, well, that's enough of the tricky stuff. So let's let's end up in the next few minutes with... first of all, did you know that pi arose in a court case in Indiana, in the States? The state legislature of Indiana in 1897 had a bill proposed to them by this mathematician, or so-called mathematician. And he had got a value for pi, which is actually about 3.2, I think. And he decided that it would be a good idea that his value for pi, which, as I say, was not a very good one, if Indiana state legislature could vote, could basically make it illegal for anyone to use his value, then this would give lots of royalties to the state of Indiana. So any school in Indiana could use his value, but anyone else would have to pay royalties to the state. So this is a bill for an act introducing a new mathematical truth and offered as a contribution to education to be used only in the state of Indiana, free of cost by paying any royalties, whatever, on the same, provided, accepted, and adopted by the official action of the legislature in 1897. Well, for some reason, it went to the House Committee on Swamp Lands, and I don't know what that was about, and then to the Committee on Education, where it was passed, because, of course, they didn't know. They had this chap who said, who blinded them with phony science. And so, being enacted by the General Assembly of the State of Indiana, it had been found the circular areas to the quadrant of the circumference as the area of an equilateral rectangle. It's a square on one side. The diameter employed as a... Of course, they didn't understand a word of all this, but they were quite happy to pass it because they didn't know any better. So the bill then went to the Committee on Temperance. One wonders about Indiana, where it's noted. But fortunately, it was just about to go through in its second reading when a mathematics professor came in trying to raise money for science research, and he found out about this. He said this is a load of rubbish, and he actually managed to persuade the legislature not to pass it. And I mean, it's still somewhere in the Committee on Temperance papers, but it has never actually been enacted. But anyway, so there's a nice jolly story. Here are some completely bizarre results before I come on to my last topic, which is very quick. Now, some of you all know of Ramanujan. Ramanujan was this amazing Indian mathematician who probably one of the most, if not the most, intuitive mathematician of all time. He came up with some completely bizarre results, of which here are some. And he wrote to, I mean, he was completely untaught. He had basically some school teaching, and he also had a book that he, with 5,000 formulae in it, that he read avidly. He started proving results, but they were completely unlike things that anyone had met before. And he wrote to G.H. Hardy, probably the most important pure mathematician of the first half of the last century, in Cambridge, sent these results, and Hardy looked at them completely amazed. He said, these results must be true because no one would have had the imagination to invent them. And so he invited Ramanujan over, and they worked for 5 years, and they produced some staggering papers on partitions and various other things. How many of you saw the film, The Man Who Loved Infinity? A couple of you. It's been in Birmingham recently. And I think you can get it online. It is a wonderful film about Ramanujan coming over, his conflicts, but joint work with Hardy in the time of the First World War and various other things. But he came up with these completely amazing results. 1 over pi is 2 root 2 over 9,801 times the sum of all that stuff. And yet, they're correct. And how did he get them? He said it's divine inspiration from the goddess that he worshipped every day. Again, quite remarkable. It's an amazing story. Those of you who, anyone listened to Great Lives last week? Great Lies of Matthew Paris's program, where they invite a celebrity to talk about someone from the past, and then they get an expert. Well, they couldn't find an expert, so they got me in. And if you listen to on iPlayer, you can hear the Ramanujan story, and I talk about some of the pi results and so on, and the stuff on partitions. And it's a fascinating story. The celebrity, by the way, is Akram Khan, who... a dancer and choreographer. He choreographed the opening of the London Olympics, and it's an interesting program. The Borwens and Chudnovskis, Americans and Canadians, they came up with some even more results. And that last one says that, in fact, there's a nice simple formula for pi. You can calculate digit by digit as long as you work in base 16. And yet there isn't such a formula for base 10. Well, my last topic, which is very quick, let me just say that in from the 1940s onwards, in comes a computer, and it can do all these 10 to the minus 1 calculations very, very quickly. In 1949, ENIAC in America spent 70 hours and got 2,037 decimal places. NORC, I can't remember what that stands for, in 13 minutes got 3,000. Pegasus, 33 hours, got 10,000. And IBM, 1 hour and 40 minutes, got 10,000. And the numbers go up and up and up. The Chudnovskis, these brothers that live in New York, they've got up to a billion decimal places. And then some Japanese have gone up to 1 trillion, and now I think 5 trillion is the latest I heard about. So there are, you know, there are lots and lots of decimal places to play with. Why calculate so many digits? After all, if you know 3.1416, that's enough for most practical purposes. If you go up to 39 decimal places, which, as I said, was known in the 1600s, then you know anything you want in the universe. I mean, NASA and some of these space probes, when they do their calculations about sending things off to Mars and places a lot further, then they find that, in fact, if you know pi to 39 decimal places, then you can get anywhere in the universe to within 2 inches. So you probably don't need all that many for most purposes. So why do you do all that? Well, partly to test the accuracy of a new computer. If you've got a new computer, you get it to calculate pi, say, what's the 1 billionth decimal place? And if it gets it wrong, well, you don't have so much trust in it. If it gets it right, well, that may increase your faith in it, and so you can try some other numbers as well. It also enables us to look for patterns. For example, you'd expect that each of the 10 digits occurs the same number of times. And if you actually look at the first trillion digits of pi, which you may or may not ever have done, then you actually still see they are pretty much all around the same number. So they're very accurate. And I'll end up with a very simple problem, in case you haven't understood some of the later stuff. Here's a nice simple problem, which I'm sure many of you have come across before. So it's circling the Earth. Okay, the Earth's circumference is about 2,500 miles, assuming it's a perfect sphere, or 132 million feet. Now, suppose you, not in practice, but suppose you tie a string tightly around the Earth, okay? Just round the Earth. And then you extend the string by just about 6 feet, okay? So you've got 132 million feet, and you just add 6 more. And you prop it up all the way around. How near the Earth is it? How far from the Earth is it? It's obviously a very, very small amount, isn't it? Let's see. Well, if the radius of the Earth is r, the original string has length 2 pi r, when you extend the string by 6 feet, it's 2 pi, the new circumference is 2 pi r plus 2 pi, which is 2 pi times r plus 1. So the new radius is r plus 1. So everywhere the string is now 1 foot off the ground. Amazing, isn't it? And you notice that r doesn't appear. So that's the same whether you put the string around the Earth, or around your stomach, or around a tennis ball. It's the same answer. And with that, I think I'll finish. Sorry to have gone on too long. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Robin. Fascinating talk. Whistle-stop tour through the history of pi there. We're running a little bit late, but we usually like to give people a chance to answer a couple of questions, so I am going to stick to just 2 questions. And since the purpose of this lecture is for school children, I think I'll give them the chance to ask the questions first. So anyone under the age of 18 who's got a question, shove your hand up. The answer's no. Okay, so I'll throw it open to the rest of the audience then. Anyone got a question for Robin?
One thing I should say is that the history of mathematics, I think, is a fascinating subject. I think if you're to teachers, you know, please bring some history in. It makes mathematics live even more than it does already. And so many fascinating stories. And the history of mathematics has really come on quite a lot in the last few years. There's lots of things available, lots of books available. I mentioned the Marcus de Sautoy television programs. Well worth watching, these four documentaries. As I say, there are lots of books about the subject. Obviously, you want to buy my book when it comes out just before Christmas. There's even a society called the British Society for the History of Mathematics, which has about 10 meetings a year around the place, and some of them are in Birmingham. There's a meeting every Christmas. We had one last month. There's another one, I think, this year, probably around the 9th of December, a Saturday. Again, come for a whole day of varied talks on the history of mathematics. And if you'd like to join the British Society for the History of Mathematics, as I say, they do lots of exciting things and publish a bulletin and so on. Just go to just Google BSHM and you'll find their website, and it'll give you all sorts of details. But as I say, generally, the history of mathematics is an amazing subject. I remember, I think the first book I read about it was when I was about 13. And as I say, there are lots of interesting stories. And it makes the mathematics you're doing, it puts it in the context. It makes you realise why we study these subjects and where they first came from. So I would encourage you to get involved with that. And if you're a teacher, try and bring some stuff in on that when you're teaching.
Good advice. Right, anyone got one question for Robin? Anyone? Burning
yes.
Desire? There you go, your hand up went up first.
Oh, there's one here first.
Oh, okay, go for it.
That was really Archimedes, because he actually got, when he had the 96-sided polygon, he got an answer, but it was a bit clumsy, so he approximated a bit, and he was the one that came up with 3 1/7, as I showed you for the 90. So I think Archimedes is the one that we can credit for that. So that's a good question, yes. The lecture is too short to tell you. Yeah, I think my favourite is this 500-digit one that this friend of mine sort of came up with. I think, I don't know, I probably don't go beyond 6 or 7, but yeah. Anyone who wants to ask questions, we'd better stop now, but if you want to, I'm going to stay around for a few minutes, and so do come up and ask individual questions. So thank you very
much. Thank you very much. Right, final round of applause for Robin. I'd just like to thank Robin for coming. He's come up all the way from Oxford for us this evening for our entertainment. The next one of these is on the 15th of February. I assure you the lecture theatre will be a larger size. it's by Dr. Alan Lowe, who's one of the School of Mathematics academics, and it's about Sudokus and a special Latin square. So thank you very much for coming.